You all are welcome to our webinar series of CL2, and today we are discussing the last time paper. This is CL2 paper of 2021 February exam. As per the examiner's comments, the passing rates and the statistics are little alarming and daunting. I don't want to share the statistics with you all, but anyway, let's see how best we can overcome our problems, get over our problems, and to make it a success this time. But apparently, CL2 paper last time seems to be a very fair, reasonable paper. And if you did your job properly, and if your writing skills are all right, I don't think there is anything that will prevent you from getting through the exam. I'm still wondering why this paper is considered to be so challenging. There is nothing challenging. I mean, everything is up to the expectations and the standard, and it's a very nice and a balancing paper. So I wish even this time the paper will be something similar to this, so then you can secure your 50 marks. I wish our discussions will be an immense use for all of you all to succeed at the exam in July. Now, since the exam in July is an online exam, there are different protocols and arrangements, and CA Sri Lanka will make you aware as to what those arrangements and protocols will be. So I'm not going to share about those with you all guys. And the authorized publications and the books that can be taken to the exam will be different this times. Even that will be notified to you all in due course before the exam. So I just leave it to the institute, and they will look after their babies. As you all know, the paper is consisting of three areas, section 1, section 2 and section 3. Section 1 is where there are 10 multiple questions, and there is no specific area where the multiple questions are set from. So the examiner has the liberty and the freedom and the free hand to set questions from anywhere, from each and every single small nooks and corners of the syllabus. That is where the danger is when there are multiple questions. Even a tiny small concept which you think can be negligible can be tested at the exam. So you need to be prepared, you need to be careful. So multiple questions may not be as easy as you think it can be. So there can be some danger in it. For you to answer the multiple questions, you should know ins and out from A to Z, everywhere of the syllabus. You must have a comprehensive coverage and comprehensive understanding of entire syllabus for you to answer the questions of MCQs. And section 2 is the question, section where there are 4 questions that carries 10 marks each, and section 3 is little different. There are only 2 questions in section 3 or the third sections. One question carries 20 marks each. Each question carries 20 marks each. And the 6th question is a console question which carries 20 marks. And the last question is bit of a comprehensive one that also carries 20. So that is the paper structure, and you all know it. And we will see the first section where there are multiple MCQ questions. Now, last time February exam, the recommended publications were, the recommended publications that were allowed to be taken to the exam hall were the standard book, IFRIC 6, Corporate Governance and SME. Now, Corporate Governance is something which you can't buy heart. You need not to do that either. And since the corporate governance booklet is a very tiny and a small thing, you know, you need to only understand the concepts and keep that in your mind. And easily you can copy the answers from the corporate governance book. So, you need to keep that important areas highlighted, and just a matter of turning to the pages and to see where that section is, and you can straight away extract the answers from the book. And so is SME. You need not to by heart and memorize all the sections in SLFRS for SME. And we have learnt some easy methods. You know what the exceptions are. You know what the implications are. You need to keep those implications highlighted, and straight away you can copy those answers from SLFRS for SME, or else you can just go through that and then you can develop and build up your own answers at the exam. And remember, language has been a main barrier. Writing skills are not up to the expectations, very poor. So that is one area where there is room for development, and you need to keep developing your writing skills. It has not to be 100% perfect in grammar, but you should be able to communicate to the examiner, impress the examiner, you know the fact, and you can answer and develop and construct your answer in such a way that the requirements of the examiner can be satisfied, and you can shape it to the requirements of the action. So those are the requirements, and if you are fully okay, if you know the subject, if you can develop your answers based on the action verbs, so there is nothing that can prevent you from passing the exam. So the statistics this time will be good. And one thing that you will keep postponing your studies until the last moment, and sometimes you will speak to us and ask, so what areas you think will be highly testable, examinable, and then you do selective learning, and which is a danger. Please stop doing the selective learning, and you need to know everything. You need not to know everything, I mean perfectly. You need to score only 50 marks, but have to have a reasonable understanding of the entire syllabus to score 50 marks. So, we will start discussion. We are moving to question number 1. Also, you need to keep the required recommended publications with your corporate governance book, SLFRS for SME book, and accounting standard book. Question number 1.1. A board of directors of a company listed on the Colombo Stock Exchange is in the process of appointing members to the audit committee. The following are the details of the directors: Ramesh, chairman executive; Gayan, independent non-executive director, fellow chartered marketer; PL, executive director, fellow chartered accountant; Praveen, independent non-executive director, fellow chartered accountant; Kamal, independent non-executive director, engineer; Kavin, executive director, lawyer. Who are the directors that should be appointed to the audit committee? And if you have the corporate governance book, let's see where the audit committee is in the corporate governance book, that is in page number 24. Page number 24, audit committee explains the compositions of the members of the audit committee. You need not to buy hard, but keep it highlighted. You should know the fact. Paragraph number 3.1 says, the board should establish an audit committee exclusively of non-executive directors, with a minimum of 3 non-executive directors, of whom at least 2 should be independent. Now, you cannot include anyone else as members in the audit committee, but only the non-executive directors. And you all should know who non-executive directors are and how to distinguish non-executive directors from executive directors. Now, the examiner has given us the list of the directors, indicating in front whether they are executives or non-executives. Ramesh, chairman executives, he is not qualified to be a member in the audit committee. Gayan, independent non-executive director, he is qualified to be a member of the audit committee, no issue. Pial, executive director, he is not qualified to be a member in the audit committee. Praveen, independent non-executive director, fellow chartered accountant, he is qualified to be a member in the audit committee. Kamal, independent non-executive director, he is qualified to be a member of the audit committee. Kavin, executive director, he is not qualified to be a member of the audit committee. So, only the non-executive directors are those who are qualified to be the members of the audit committee. So, from the list given, we will keep picking the directors who are non-executives, and then we can take Gayan, we can take Praveen, and we can take Kamal. We can take Kamal. So, what should be the answer then? So, the answer has to be C, Gayan, Praveen and Kamal. They are the directors who are non-executives and they are the people who are qualified to be the members in the audit committee. So, the answer has to be C for 1.1 question. You have been given the following information about a few companies. A company listed on the Colombo Stock Exchange which has a turnover of 100 million rupees. Second, a leasing company which has 100 employees. A privately owned company which at the end of the previous financial year had gross assets of 400 million rupees. Public corporations engaged in the sale of goods or the provision of services. A privately owned company which at the end of the previous financial year had liabilities to banks and other financial institutions of 50 million rupees. Which of the above companies are required to prepare financial statements in compliance with Sri Lanka Accounting Standards per Sri Lanka Accounting Standard Accounting and Auditing Standard Act number 15 of 1995? Now, Sri Lanka Accounting and Auditing Standard Act number 15 of 1995 introduces a kind of business entities identified to be specified business entities. So, this Act of number 15, 1995 Sri Lanka Accounting and Auditing Standard Act introduces a list of business entities which will fall under this category of specified business entity. And if you take even the SLFRS for SME book, some of these entities are listed in the book there in page number 7, but that is not the exhaustive list, and this is there in your study pack as well, as far as I know. This time, since your exam is an online exam, you will be permitted to keep your study pack as well as a recommended publications. Then once again, if you have the study pack, if you have this SLFRS for SME book, you can just refer to the pages, relevant sections and find out what the specified business entities are. If it is a specified business entity, you, whether you like or not, you need to apply full SLFRSs. And if it is not a specified business entity, or in other words, if it is a business entity which falls into the other category like SME, small and medium enterprises, you need not to apply the full SLFRSs. You need to apply the simplified, concise version of SLFRSs. We call it SLFRS for SME and this one. So then, since I can remember the entire list, I know what the answer should be, but you need not to by heart. You need to have a reasonable understanding what these entities are. So straight away you can see it from the study text and the SLFRS for SME book, and let me go through it once again one by one and see what and what of these list can be specified and what of these entities in the list will not be. A company listed on the Colombo Stock Exchange which has a turnover of 100 million. So, what is the, question, which of the above companies are required to prepare financial statements in compliance with Sri Lanka accounting standards per Sri Lanka accounting and auditing standard act number 15/1995. A company listed on the Colombo Stock Exchange, a listed company has to follow full SLFRSs, not it will never fall into the category of SMEs under the prevailing, you know, legal framework, regulatory framework. A leasing company which has 100 employees. Now, a leasing company by and large will never fall under SME category, has to be a specified business entity which is required to follow the full SLFRSs. A privately owned company which at the end of the previous financial year had gross assets of 400 million. And even this company, where the asset base is 400 or above, has to fall within the specified business entity category and will be required to follow full SLFRSs, and they cannot, it does not fall into the SME category. Public corporations engaged in the sale of goods or the provision of services, even that falls within this category of specified business entities and should follow full SLFRSs and should not follow SLFRS for SME. A privately owned company which at the end of the previous financial year had liabilities to banks and other financial institutions of 50 million rupees, and as per the list of specified business entities, this particular criteria does not make an entity a specified business entity. So this need not to follow full SLFRSs. So, what are the entities in the list given that should follow full SLFRSs? The entities in the first one, second one, third and the fourth one. So, what should be the correct answer for 1.2? The correct answer has to be, for 1.2 C. First one, second one, third and the fourth one, correct answer should be C. Tion Private Limited purchased machinery at a cost of 30 million rupees. On 1st January 2019, the useful life of the machinery is 10 years and has no residual value. Capital allowance is available at the rate of 25% on cost. Tion Private Limited also has 20 million rupees of development cost capitalized on 1st January 2018, which is amortized over 10 years. These costs have already been deducted in full for tax purpose. In the same year, Tion Private Limited pays income tax at the rate of 28%. What is the deferred tax asset or liability as at 31st December 2019? And you can't parachute to an answer just for the sake of, you can't do it blindly. For you to arrive at the correct answer, you need to do some calculations, do the calculations elsewhere, and then see what the correct answer should be. So this question is given from LKS12 taxation, and we have started doing the webinars on LKS12, that is halfway done, so the balance part is yet to be completed. But to answer this part of the questions, what we have done up to now in LKS12 is more than enough, right. Now to calculate deferred taxes, you need to first calculate temporary differences between the accounting profit and the taxable profit. The little knowledge you have tells you that to calculate the differences, temporary differences between the accounting profit and the taxable profit, we never look at the accounting profit and the taxable profits, but instead we are supposed to look at the accounting balance sheet and the tax balance sheet. Whatever the values where the assets and the liabilities are recognized in the accounting balance sheet should be the accounting written down value. Similarly, the values where the same assets and the liabilities are recognized in an imaginary, psychologically imagined, visualized balance sheet, tax balance sheet, should be the tax base. So this tax balance sheet that I am talking about does not exist anywhere in the world. It's completely an imaginary exercise, a visualized exercise. You need to close your eyes and to figure out and to imagine and to visualize a tax balance sheet that does not exist anywhere in the world. Now, coming to the question straight, there are two items for which the accounting treatment looks different from the treatment of the same item for taxation. And based on that only there will be differences between the accounting profit and the taxable profit. First one is the machinery. Accounting written down value, apparently with the facts and information given, accounting written down value seems to be the cost minus cumulative depreciation. Cost is 30 million. So when has it been acquired? On 1st January 19, so the examiner requires us to calculate deferred taxes on 31 December 19 in 1 year's time. How does the entity depreciate assets? It is on the useful life of the machinery is 10 years and has no residual value. So we will depreciate it over 10 years time evenly. Now on the date on which deferred taxes are calculated, cumulative depreciation figure should be 3 million. Accounting written down value should be 27 million. Minus tax base of machinery, tax base has to be picked from the tax balance sheet, and this same asset will be recognized into the tax balance sheet at the cost minus cumulative capital allowances, which is at the rate of 25% on cost. So let me work it out now. 30 million should be the cost of machinery minus cumulative depreciation of 7.5 million rupees, and tax base has to be 22.5 million rupees, and take the difference. Difference has to be, this is 500,000, this is for 4.5 million rupees, say temporary difference 4.5 into the tax rate of 28%. So deferred tax figure has to be 4,500,000 into 28%, 1,260,000. Then you need to decide whether this is a deferred tax asset or a deferred tax liability. So we have given you two methods basically. Using one of the two methods, you can decide what it is, whether it is a deferred tax asset or a deferred tax liability. simply you need to compare the tax base with the accounting written down value. If the tax base of an asset is lower than the accounting written down value, the result in deferred tax figure should be a deferred tax liability. So, 1,260,000 should be a deferred tax liability. So, there is another item given. So, let us take the aggregate deferred tax figure at the end. So, what does it say? Tion company also has 20 million rupees of development cost capitalized on 1st January 2018, which is amortized over 10 years time. These costs have already been deducted in full for tax purpose in the same year. Tion Private Limited pays income tax at the rate of 28%. Say capitalized development cost has to be an intangible asset. So, let me take accounting written down value of intangible asset. The total cost capitalized has been 20 million and it was done on 1st January 2018, 2 years ahead of the date on which we do the deferred tax calculations. Now, there has to be 2 years cumulative amortization. So, that should be 4 million. Accounting written down value of the intangible asset should be 16 million rupees minus tax base. So, what have the tax people done? Tax people, without recognizing that into an asset in their simple double entry accounting, they have simply debited that to an expenditure account and completely deducted it from the taxable profit in 2018. So, the intangible asset that appears in the accounting balance sheet does not equally appear in the tax balance sheet. Why? They have deducted it fully from the taxable profit. In other words, without it being debited to an intangible asset account, they have debited that to an expenditure account. So, we talk about this intangible asset in the accounting balance sheet. The intangible asset that appears in the accounting balance sheet does not equally appear in the tax balance sheet. Tax base as a result should be 0. Temporary difference has to be 16 million into 28%. 16 million into 28%, 4,480,000. 4,480,000. See what it is, deferred tax asset to deferred tax liability. So, we talk about an intangible asset, and that is a titled captioned matter, and that has an accounting written down value of 16 million, tax base of it is 0. Where the tax base of an asset is lower than the accounting written down value, result in deferred tax figure should be a deferred tax liability. So, 4,480,000 has to be a deferred tax liability once again. Take the total deferred tax liability value on the reporting date, 4,480,000 plus 1,260,000, it has to be 5,740,000. So, what has to be the correct answer? For 1.3, so that has to be answer A, 5,740,000, answer A. So, we are moving on to 1.4, question number 1, part 4. Mom Limited commenced constructions of a building on 1st March 2018. Commencement date 1st April 2018. On this date, Mom Limited received funds borrowed specifically for this construction of 25 million rupees. on the same date, they have received 25 million rupees from the borrowing, and they have done this borrowing specifically for this project. So, this particular bank loan or whatever the debt instrument is directly attributable to the constructions. How do we know it? This entity wouldn't have ever received this, obtained this borrowing if not for the construction. If not for the constructions, the borrowing wouldn't have been there. If not for the borrowing, this entity wouldn't have ever been able to finance the construction of the asset. So, these two are interconnected, so directly attributable. And this is at 11% interest rate, 11% interest rate. This loan is repayable on 1st March 2020. On 1st July 19, MAM Limited used 10 million from generally borrowed funds, 10 million. What is the date? That is on 1st July 19. 1st July 19, they are using another 10 million rupees, 10 million rupees from generally borrowed funds. General borrowings include two bank loans of 20 million rupees obtained at 12%, 20 million at 12% and 15 million at 13% interest. Per annum, construction of the building was completed on 30th October 19. What is the borrowing cost to be capitalized per LKS 23 borrowing costs? LKS 23 gives two accounting prescriptions on borrowing cost. Borrowing cost incurred on qualifying asset should be capitalized, in other words, should be added to the carrying value of the building or the property or the qualifying asset itself. Borrowing cost incurred for other than qualifying assets should be expensed immediately to the profit and loss. So, those are the two simple accounting prescriptions given by LKS 23. And this requirement of borrowing cost being capitalized does not seem to be as simple as you think. Even the capitalization of borrowing cost should be done within a specified framework, within the required parameters and the boundaries. The amount to be capitalized has to be in accordance with LKS 23. The commencement of the capitalization of borrowing cost has to be again in accordance with LKS 23. When to stop capitalizing borrowing cost again has to be in accordance with LKS 23, and when I can't decide. Here what it says is, to construct the building or to construct the qualifying asset, we have specifically taken 25 million rupees worth of a loan. LKS 23 has been pretty clear on this matter. If there is a directly attributable or specifically obtained borrowing, you need not to think of anything else. Very simple accounting. The entire borrowing cost, simply the interest component, I don't like to say the borrowing cost is the interest component. That is a wrong interpretation, but let me use that term for my convenience for the moment. The interest component on this 25 million loan specifically taken to finance the construction of the qualifying asset should be added to the cost of the asset, and you need not to think of anything else. So, let me do the calculations now. 25 million into 11% into how many months? So, we started the constructions on 1st March 2018. and we completed the construction on 30th October 2019. So it has been running for 2 years altogether, but let's count the number of months. It's little less than 2 years. For 2018, 10 months, starting from 1st March up to 31st December 18, 10 months. Once again, in 2019, starting from 1st January up to 30th October 19, there are another 10 months, altogether 20 months. So this is divided by 12 and multiplied by 20, you will get the answer. 25 million into 11% divided by 12 into 20. There the amount of borrowing cost to be capitalized should be 4,583,333. And there is something more. So what is it? Now, apart from you utilizing 25 million rupees, also you have drawn another 10 million rupees, not from the bank loan specifically taken for the constructions of the property, and maybe those two loans would have been taken for some other purpose, but then since you are running out of money, you would have drawn 10 million rupees from these two loans. And the examiner does not clearly say where this 10 million has been drawn from, whether it was from 20 million loan or 15 million rupee, 15 million loan. If the examiner said it, gave that information, this wouldn't have been that hard. So don't expect the life to be always rosy, and there can be some hardships as well, stamina, and will be used to it, no problem. Then 20 million and 15 million would have been in a single bank account where there is 35 million rupees, and this is where we have drawn 10 million rupees from, and this 35 million is including funds borrowed at 12%, also that is including funds borrowed at 13% as well. So you cannot apply 12%. You cannot apply 13% either. Instead, to calculate the amount of interest on 10 million rupees utilized to the constructions, you need to calculate a common rate. So what should be the common rate? We call it capitalization rate, or some people call it weighted average rate. So we need to do a small calculation. Different methods are there, but let me give you like two methods. We can calculate weighted average cost. 12% multiplied by the weightage. Weightage will be 20 out of 35 plus 13%, 15 million out of 35. So let's take the percentage, I mean common percentage. 20 divided by 35 into 12, 6.857 plus 15 divided by 35 into 13, that is 5.57. 5.57 plus 6.857 should be 12.427. Then let's apply that common. It's not 12%, neither is it 13%, and this is a combined rate based on the weightages of the funds that were available from each bank loan, and this is the common rate we can apply on the funds utilized to complete the construction. So let me work out on interest component now. How much have you used? 10 million into 12.427%, and this is the annual rate. We used 10 million rupees on 1st July 19, the constructions ended on 30th October 2019. So for how many months? July, August, September, October, for 4 months period, this is to be multiplied by 4 divided by 12. How much? this into 10 million divided by 12 into 4. So, that is another 414,233. So, altogether the total borrowing cost to be capitalized 4,583,333 plus 414,233 should be 4,997,566. And you can have another method. So, let me explain that as well. So, you can use any method that you think is easy for you all. Let me work out annual interest for the 20 million loan. So, 20 million into 12% should be 2,400,000. Plus, also let us work out interest for the second 15 million loan. 15 million into 30% should be 1,950,000. Now, what do we do? 20 million loan plus 15 million loan, both should be considered to be a single loan for which we have incurred interest of altogether 4,350,000. So, you need to settle your mind to accept the fact that 20 million loan plus 15 million loan are no longer two separate loans, but should be a single loan for which we have incurred a total interest of how much? 4,350,000, and that is to be divided by how much? 35 million total loan value. What is the common interest rate? Divided by 35 million. So, once again you get the same answer, 12.427 or 428, and this is divided by 12 into 4, you will get the same answer. So, different approaches are there. It's the way you think is easy for you. Either you can use this weighted average cost model or you can use the second model. It's up to you all to decide which method is suitable for you all guys. And finally, the amount of interest to be capitalized to the qualifying asset should be 4,497,566, and let's see what the answer should be. 1.4. The closest answer, the examiner has rounded it to the millions. So the closest answer has to be 4,998, right? K Private Limited on 1st January 19 granted 100 share options to each of its 20 members. Each grant is conditional on the manager working for the company during 3 years for the vesting period until 31st December 2021. Fair value of each share option at the grant date is 12 rupees. The company expects 10% of the managers to leave during the 3-year period. Two managers left the company during 2019. What is the remuneration expense that should be recognized in respect of the share-based transactions for the year ended 31st December 19? So, it has been from SLFRS to share-based payment transactions. And you all know, we talk about two kinds of share-based payment transactions in SLFRS 2. What are these two? Equity settled share-based payment transactions and cash settled share-based payment transactions. So, which category does this question, or which category does the program in this question fall into? Is it into equity settled category or into cash settled category? So, it is very clear. They are granting share options in exchange of the services from the employees. So, it is like we receiving the services from the employees in exchange of the ownership. So, what do? We receive the service, in return we offer them the ownership. equity settled share based payment transactions. And if it is equity settled share based payment transactions, you need to see, you need to have your perceptions over two dimensions. What are these two? You need to see how the valuation is done. You need to see the period over which it is expensed to the profit and loss. SLFR is 2 says, if it is an equity settled share based payment transaction, value it at the fair values of equity on the granting date. And it has to be expensed to the profit and loss over the vesting period. A vesting period commences on the granting date and ends on the vesting date. So that is more than enough for us to complete that. 1st January 19 is the granting date. How many employees are there? 20. And for each employee, we will be granting 100 share options. So the total to be granted is 2000. Out of these 20 members or 20 managers of the company, we expect 10 people of them, 10% rather, of them to leave over the 3-year vesting period. So the fair value of the expenditure to be recognized over the vesting period should be also decided based on the likely, based on the number of options that are likely of being vested in 3 years time. Since 10% is going to leave, only 90% will remain. So it's very simple. Now say you are going to have your grand wedding with elite guests and you are inviting 100 people and you are going to have this grand wedding in 3 months time when the travel restrictions will be removed, lifted. Even though you are going to have this grand wedding in a 5-star hotel, the plate, cost of a plate will be 20,000. So that will be how much? 2 million rupees. So you need to spend 2 million rupees only for the hotel. But you know, the chances of everyone whom you invited coming to the party is very unlikely. And we did a small study and we just felt that out of 100 invitees, we expect only 90%. For some reason, some people will migrate, some people will go abroad, some people will have some personal issues. So lot of issues will be there. So we will expect only 90%. So are we to pay? Do we need to arrange 2 million rupees to the hotel? No, we need to arrange only 1.8 million rupees. That is the amount for the guests whom we think will be likely of being at the party on that particular date. So your cost of wedding should not be 2 million rupees, should be how much? 1.8 million rupees. So it is as simple as that. Then 20 into 100 into 90%, and this has to be multiplied by fair value of an option on the granting that is given in the question 12, and this has to be the total expenditure over 3 years vesting period. We'll divide it by 3 and calculate the expenditure for the first year. 20 into 100 into 90 into 12 divided by 3. So the expenditure for the first year should be 7,002. So let's see where is it up. The answer has to be C, 1.5. The correct answer should be C 7,200. Right. The conceptual framework for financial reporting is concerned with general purpose financial statements. Which of the following parties are not directly aimed at under the objective of general purpose financial statements? So the existing webinar series were started On 30th April 2020 last year, I started your discussions of CL2 with this first topic of conceptual framework. And the latest version of the conceptual framework says, when an entity prepares financial statements, so it's not for the entire populations living all over the world. When you do something, when I teach this, I am aiming a particular target group. That is the students who are going to sit for CL2 paper in coming July. Similarly, when you prepare the financial statements, we are not targeting everyone who will be likely of going through our financial statements, and we have also similarly a target group. So within this target group are there four parties basically. And you need not to by heart, but you need to understand the concept. Who are these four parties? Existing investors. So you need to make your financial informations as detailed as the existing shareholders want to look at. And I mean, you need to make it as detailed as the existing shareholders demand informations. For the prospect investors, and those investors are not the existing investors already in the company, but there can be some investors who have some interest and they are likely of making investments in the company in the future. Lenders, lot of lenders will be there, other creditors. So those are the four basic groups for whom we prepare the financial statements. At the back of your mind, you know we prepare our financial statements by making it as detailed as possible, not for everyone living all over the world, but for four targeted groups. Who are these targeted groups? Existing shareholders, prospect investors or possible investors in the future, lenders and other creditors. So what should be the correct answer then? General public cannot be included, so it has to be A, B, C only. A, B, C only. But what is the examiner's expectation? The group for whom we do not, aim in preparing financial statements. So we aim existing and potential investors, we aim creditors, we aim lenders as well. So the only party for whom we do not aim at in preparing financial statements will be general public. So the correct answer for 1.6 should be D. I hope it was clear. The following is an extraction from notes to the financial statements of a company. Fair value of the properties was determined using the market comparable method. The valuations have been performed by the valuer and are based on proprietary databases benchmarking property prices of transactions of a similar nature, locations and condition. Major adjustments to proprietary databases were made using significant unobservable inputs in determining the fair value. Which level of fair value measurement has been applied in the valuation of above projects? Level 1, level 2, level 3. Combinations of all levels, and I must do a small brief on this before I give you the answer. Now, in deciding the fair value of assets and liabilities, we use lot of tools, techniques, methods. We call them informations, data, we call them inputs. Now, you know fair value measurement should be a market based, wherever possible, whoever who decides and determines the fair value, it has to be from the market. It cannot be just a market, it has to be an active market. Now, if the inputs you use to decide the fair value are relatively not from the market, then the accuracy and the reliability of your FAIR valuations will be little questionable. I mean, not that I am saying it was wrong, but since it is required to be taken from the active market, as much as you can to the fullest extent possible, you need to pick FAIR values from the markets, from the active markets, or using some active market information, you should be able to determine the FAIR value. Now, the FAIR, the inputs used to decide the FAIR value to the active market, less reliable your FAIR valuations will be. Then, the inputs we use to decide the FAIR values will be taken to three levels depending on how close they are to the active market, so how far they are from the active markets. If you take quoted price from active market without adjustments, so that is what we will classify and put it under level 1, the most reliable method of FAIR value or most reliable inputs of FAIR valuations, quoted price, active markets, no adjustments. But if you take the quoted price from active markets, but if you incorporate some adjustments to arrive at the final FAIR valuations, no longer can we keep it under level 1, so it has to fall into the second level, level 2. Also, if you take active market prices of similar assets or comparable or similar assets. Or non-active market prices of identical assets, they are also under level 2. But then again, if you take active market price of comparable assets, comparable means what? Now, you have a girlfriend or a boyfriend, your crush. Maybe your girlfriend is like a nagging and whining girlfriend. And she might say, look here, don't compare me with anyone else. I am unique. I have been born only for you. And you have no life without me. You are just no one if not for me. You can't compare me with anyone else. Meaning what? You comparing your crush with another one is like you trying to equate your crush with another girl. She does not like you to equate you to another one. She is unique. She is, you know, she has her own identity. And she cannot be replaced with anyone else. She is unique. No replacements at all. Comparing means what? Trying to equate, trying to replace, compare. That is what you mean by comparisons. Comparable assets means similar assets, active market prices of comparable similar assets or non-active market prices of identical assets. And if you take them subject to without adjustments, active market prices of similar assets, non-active market prices of identical assets, take them without adjustments and then only it will be at level 2. If you do adjustments, then it will fall to level 3. Now, if you use informations that are not related to markets, active markets, and if you use entity specific informations for FAIR valuations, that is far away from the relativeness to the market, and then it has to be under level 3. Now, just to give a simple illustration, company A is a listed company and there are three shareholders, B, C and D. B is holding 60%, C is holding 20% and D is holding 20%. Now, C does not have the control, neither does D have the control, but B has the control. And if the market price of a share that B holds in company A is 100 rupees, the shares that B holds in company A should not be exactly similar to the shares that C is holding in company A. Why? The shares of B empowers B to control company A also to have ownership in company A. But the shares that C is holding in company A does not empower C to control company A. C has only a 20% ownership in company A. So, the shares that B holds in company A will be little expensive. Why? The shares that B holds in company A empowers B to control company A also gives the ownership of company A to B. So, if the market price of a share that B holds in company A is 100 rupees, that itself cannot be taken as the fair value of a share that C holds in company A. There has to be a small adjustment, some allowance has to be deducted for the control premium. I mean, since C does not have the control, the market price of a share that C holds in company A should be little lower than the fair value of a share that B holds in company A. I hope it was clear. But the shares that C and D hold in company A should be identical to each other all in all through and through. Why? C does not have the control, neither does D have the control in company A. But both of these guys have ownership to some extent, 20% ownership. If C decides the market value of a share that C holds in company A is just 90 rupees and that is active market price, that is quoted price, and the fair value of a share that D holds in company A should also be 90. D decides the fair value of a share that he holds in company A by taking the market price, quoted price on the active market of an identical asset, no adjustments, then it has to be level 1. But if C decides to take the fair value of a share that B holds in company A, subject to a small allowance, 10% adjustment was done for not the shares empowering C to control company A. Since that allowance was made, the fair value is not at level 1, it has to be level 2. Why? We have taken active market price, quoted price, and we incorporated some adjustments. So, the relativeness was little lower. I mean, since we did some adjustments, incorporated some adjustments, the input is no longer at level 1, it has to be level 2. This is bit of a lengthy discussion. Some more examples need to go into that. So, as a result, here the company, the way it was explained in the question, is using market prices of comparable properties, similar properties. If you use active market prices of comparable, similar properties, it has to be at level 2. But if you incorporate adjustments to the active market prices of comparable assets, no longer can we keep it at level 2, it has to drop to level 3. So, this input has to be at level 3, at not at level 1 or 2. So, the correct answer should be C, level 3 input. 1.8, the following details are related to a machine purchased by a company. Due to existence of the impairment indications, the management has decided to carry out an impairment test for the machine. The machine has been purchased at 17.5 million rupees 3 years ago. At the inception, both useful life and residual values were assumed to be 8 years and 1.5 million rupees respectively. The machine can be sold for 8 million rupees. However, a sales commission of 5% has to be incurred on the selling price. The value in use of the machine is estimated at 7.5 million rupees. The above figures are as at 31st March 19 unless specifically mentioned. The impairment provisions for the machine as at 31st March 19 is, you need to do a small calculation. To conduct the impairment review, you need the carrying value and recoverable value. So, what does LKS 36 say the recoverable value should be? It has to be the higher of value in use and fair value less cost to sell. Right. The carrying value has to be cost minus cumulative depreciation. Cost is 17,500,000. So, let us do the calculations of cumulative depreciations elsewhere. 17,500,000 cost minus residual value is 1,500,000. 1,500,000 residual value, and this is divided by 8 years. How old is the asset by now? We have bought it on. It was purchased 3 years ago, so we will take the cumulative depreciation. 17.5 minus 1.5 should be 16 million divided by 8, 2 million. So, cumulative depreciations as of the impairment review date should be 6 million, carrying value should be 11,500,000. An asset is considered to have suffered an impairment loss where the carrying value of the asset cannot be recovered from the future cash flows. An entity can contribute to a cash flow only in two different ways. Either we need to put that into the continuous use and to get it to make money, so we call it the value in use. Or else if you do not decide to use it continuously and to sell it, how else does this asset contribute to a cash flow? By being sold in a single sale transactions, then the cash flow should be the selling price, which we call the fair value, minus whatever the cost required to be incurred to get the sale transaction to happen. So, we are given informations. The machine can be sold for 8 million rupees, that is the fair value, minus commission of sale of 5%, so that will be 400,000 rupees rather. So, the fair value less cost to sell should be 7.6 million rupees. The value in use of the machine is 7.5 million. Now, if you can use it over the rest of the lifetime, you can get the asset to make you 7.5 million cash flow, but if you decide to sell it right now, you can sell it at 7.6 million rupees. So, what will you think you must do? You should sell it and recover 7.6 million rupees. Still, the carrying value is pretty higher than the recoverable value. The value of the asset in the books cannot be fully recovered from the future cash flows, no matter how we expect the asset to generate cash flows. So, what is the shortfall? 11,500,000 minus 7.6 million3.9 million should be the impairment loss. So, what is the answer? A. 1.9, Luminex PLC has decided to apply modified retrospective approach for its lease agreements existing as at 1st April 2019. Details pertaining to one of the lease agreements are given below. Rent advance and the rent payable balance as at 31st March 2019 was 750,000 rupees and 500,000 rupees respectively. The rent payable balance was solely due to outstanding rentals, and the company settled the entire outstanding balance during the first week of April 2019. Present value of the remaining lease payments as at 1st April 2019 was 5,625,000 rupees, excluding payments made for the outstanding rent balance of balance as at 31st March 2019. Lease liability and right of use asset balance of the asset as at 1st April 2019 respectively was I am not going to discuss in detail the first time adoption of SLF RA 16, bit of a lengthy one, but let me give you the answer. Now, by 1st April 2019, what is the present value of the remaining rentals to be paid? 5,625,000. But you know, there is another 500,000 rent payable by 31st March 2019. Now, 5,625,000 seems to be the present value of the remaining lease payments as at 1st April 2019. So obviously, this has to include the balance of rent payable by 31st March 2019. Then the total value should be 6,125,000. That is the total liability by 1st April 2019. And the right of use asset should not only include the rentals to be further paid, also the rentals already paid. And 5,625,000 is the present values of the rentals to be further paid, and we have paid an advance. What is the advance payment? Advance payment has been 750,000. So what is the answer here? 6,375,000. So what should be the correct answer then? D, lease liability should be 6,125,000 and the right of use asset should be 6,375,000. 1.10, which of the following best reflects the main relationship between CA Sri Lanka and International Accounting Standards Board with respect to the accounting standards setting process? CA Sri Lanka, considering International Financial Reporting Standards and International Accounting Standards issued by IASB when issuing Sri Lanka Accounting Standards. Right. Now, CA Sri Lanka does not compose accounting standards on their own. Since CA Sri Lanka is a member of IASB, the original accounting standards composed by IASB will be adopted within the Sri Lankan accounting practice, and that part is done by CA Sri Lanka. So out of these 4 points, the correct answer has to be A. So it has to be A, CA Sri Lanka, considering International Financial Reporting Standards and International Accounting Standards issued by IASB when issuing Sri Lanka Accounting Standards. So that's the end of our discussion of question number 1. So we can move on to question number 2. So we are moving on to question number 2. Rotex Private Limited is a manufacturing company that meets the SME definition of the SLFRS for SME. Protex is currently applying the full SLFR research, and the management has decided to apply SLFR is for SMEs from the financial year ended 31st March 2020. Together with the restated comparative figures of the previous year, the date of transition to the SLFR is for SMEs is therefore the beginning of the comparative period. It is 1st April 18. The accountant is not sure as to how the following matters should be reflected in the financial statements for the year ended 31st March 2020. Land and buildings classified as property, plant and equipment had been measured under full SLFR research using the revaluation model. Last revaluations had been done as at 31st March 18, and the revalued amounts on that date was as follows. Land 120 million, cost is 50 million rupees, building 82 million, cost is 75 million. As of 31st March 18, the building has a remaining useful life of 10 years. The management expects to use the cost model for PPE, and SLFR is for SMEs, depreciation is calculated using the straight line method. Second part, goodwill amounting to 10 million rupees is recognized in the consolidated financial statements resulted from an acquisition of a subsidiary on 1st April 16. This had been annually tested for impairment as part of the assets of the cash generating unit to which goodwill was allocated. So far, there had been no impairment required apply the requirements of SLFR is for SMEs to the matters in 1 and 2 above in order to determine how the said matters need to be reflected in the financial statements for the year ended 31st March 2020, ignore taxation. Now, if you go to SLFR is for SME book, you can recognize or you can measure property, plant and equipment subsequently at cost or revaluation model. That is allowed even for SMEs. That is paragraph number 17.15b, page number 120, SME book. Starting from paragraph 17.15, an entity shall choose either the cost model in paragraph or the second next paragraph, cost model or the revaluation model in paragraph 17.15b. We will read those two paragraphs in a while. But its accounting policy and shall apply that policy to an entire class of property, plant and equipment, an entity shall apply the cost model to investment property whose fair value cannot be measured reliably without undue cost or effort. An entity shall recognize the costs of day-to-day servicing of an item of property, plant and equipment in profit or loss in the period in which the costs are incurred. Cost model. An entity shall measure an item of property, plant and equipment after initial recognitions at cost less any accumulated depreciations and any accumulated impairment loss. revaluation model, an entity shall measure an item of property, plant and equipment whose fair value can be measured reliably at a revalued amount, being its fair value at the date of the revaluations less any subsequent accumulated depreciations and subsequent accumulated impairment losses. Revaluation shall be made with sufficient regularity to ensure that the carrying amount does not differ materially from that which would be determined using the fair value at the date of the reporting date. Right, so then it says land and buildings classified as property, plant and equipment had been measured under full SLFRSs using the revaluation model. Last revaluations had been done as at 31st March 2018 and the revalued amounts on that date was as follows. What is the reporting date? Reporting date is 31st March 2020. So, the current financial year starts on 1st April 2020. So, the comparative period should be the year ending on 31st March 2020. I made a mistake. The current financial year starts on 1st April 2019. So, the comparative year ends on 2019. And the comparative year starts on 1st April 2018. Now, since you have been applying full SLFRSs and think of shifting from full SLFRS to SME, you need to start first applying SLFRS for SME to the beginning of the oldest comparative period. So, what is the oldest? They have only one comparative period. So, what should be the beginning date? Beginning date should be 1st April 2018. Now, they have, company has applied revaluation model under full SLFRS, that is LK 16, and the question has given us the details of the revaluations. Cost of the land is 50 million, revalued amount is 120 million. So, the last revaluations they have done has been on 1st April 2018 or 31st March 18, whatever. Land cost is 50 million, revalued amount is 120 million. Building cost is 75 million and revalued amount is 82 million. So, they would have recognized revaluation gains here 70 million, here 7 million rupees. Now, SLFRS for SME does not prohibit revaluation model from being used for the subsequent measurement of property, plant and equipment. So, there is nothing wrong. That is equally recommended by full SLFRSs, also by SLFRS for SME. Then what we can do is, if you transit from full SLFRS to SME and this revalued amount as of the date of the first recognition of SLFRS for SME as at 1st April 2018, this revalued amount of 120 million for the land and 82 million for the building can be considered to have been the deemed cost of the property as at that date. Deemed cost. What do you mean by deemed cost? The cost assumed to have been the amount that is assumed to have been the cost on that date. Why? Suppose we did not have the property with us on that date and we bought it for the first time on 1st April 18. If you bought it on that date, which market would you buy it from? we would buy it from the active market. What price would you pay? You would pay price of the asset in the active market. What do we call it? Price in the active market is called the fair value. And if you truly purchase the asset on 1st April 18, the cost of the asset wouldn't have been anything else but 120 and 82 million for the land and for the building. So as a result, not that do we recognize property, plant and equipment under revaluation model. It is just that having the property, plant and equipment been acquired on this date 1st April 18 at the cost of 120 million and 82 million and that is considered to be the cost. So, we need to continue to depreciate that amount over the rest of the lifetime. So, the lifetime of the building is given how many years? 10 years. So, 82 million should be depreciated over 10 years. So, for 2018-19 financial year, depreciation figure should be 8.2. For 19 and 20, depreciation figure should be 8.2. So, how will you construct your answer now? For this part, this is what you need to include. Date of transition to SLFRS for SME should be 1st April 18. Why? It has to be the starting date of the oldest comparative period. Then the revalued amount under full SLFRS as at 1st April 2018 should be considered to be the deemed cost, which has to be depreciated over the rest of the lifetime of the building. Accordingly, the depreciation for the building should be 8.2 million rupees for the 2 years ending on 31st March 19 and 31st March 2020. And other than that, you need not to reverse the revaluation reserves and all that. I mean, you need not to reverse the effect of the revaluations. And the effect of the revaluation gain should be adjusted to equity on 1st April 2018. So, that is how you need to do the transfer. So, that is what you need to explain. The revalued amount is considered to be the deemed cost on the date of the transition. And it is the cost which has to be depreciated over the remaining lifetime of 10 years. So, now the asset will be shown at cost model. Cost is the deemed cost. Deemed cost is how much? 120 million for the land and 82 million for the building. So, you do not depreciate lands by and large. And 8.2 million should be the respective depreciation figures for the year ending 31st March 19 and for the year ending 31st March 2020. That is it. Part 2. Goodwill amounting to 10 million rupees recognized in the consolidated financial statements resulted from an acquisition of a subsidiary on 1st April 16, this had been annually tested for impairment as part of the assets of the cash generating unit to which goodwill was allocated. So far, there had been no impairment. If you go to SLFRS for SME business combination part, let's see where it is. Business, you need to keep your books tagged so that you can easily access. Business combinations is section 19, page 133. goodwill in a business combinations. Now, SLFRS 3 says goodwill arising in a business combination should be a non-current asset and should not be amortized, and it has to be tested for impairment annually. But the way the goodwill should be treated under SLFRS for SME is little different to what I said just a while ago. Then the SLFRS for SME says if a goodwill is arising in a business combination, you need not to carry out annual impairments. You need to carry out impairments reviews only when there are conditions for possible impairments. Then you need to decide the lifetime of the goodwill, and you should start amortizing the goodwill over the estimated lifetime. And if the lifetime of the goodwill cannot be reliably estimated, you should start amortizing the goodwill over a period not exceeding 10 years, not exceeding 10, it has to be 10 years or less. That is the accounting prescription for goodwill in a business combination. Now, this particular company, since they have applied full SLFRS, has done annual impairment reviews and tests, and that is not what is needed now. And the goodwill has arisen when? On 1st April 2016. So, this is the current year ending on 31st March 2020. This is the comparative, and this is where the goodwill has arisen on 1st April 2016. What if we had applied SLFRS for SME? The goodwill value, is it given? Yes, 10 million rupees would have been here. And if they applied SLFRS for SME from the outset, the annual impairment would have been how much? 1 million rupees. And already by 1st April 2018, this company would have deducted 2 million rupees of amortizations of goodwill from the profit before 1st April 2018. Then what you must do is, even on the date of the transition to SLFRS for SME, the carrying value of the goodwill has to be 10 million rupees because there has not been an impairment. Out of 10 million, the amount of amortizations that would have been deducted from the profits of the periods before 1st April 2018 should be deducted from the cumulative retained earnings of 1st April 18. Should be deducted from the cumulative retained earnings as of 1st April 18. And 1 million rupees each should be deducted from the profits of the 2 years ending on 31st March 2020. So, 1 million should be deducted from the profit of the year ending 31st March 2019. Another 1 million should be deducted from the profit from the year ending 31st March 2020. So, that should be the accounting treatment for the goodwill under SLFRS for SME. So, what you must say is this. You can give the reference to the paragraph 19.23 of SLFRS for SME. And as per that, the goodwill should not be tested for impairments annually. Instead, the impairment reviews for the goodwill should be carried out only when there are indications for impairment. And the entity has to start amortizing the goodwill over the estimated lifetime. And if the lifetime cannot be estimated reliably, the entity should amortize it over a period not exceeding 10 years if the lifetime is not given. Lifetime is not given in the question. So, the lifetime is assumed to have been 10 years. Then, since the goodwill arose on 1st April 2016, 2 million should be deducted from the profits for the periods before beyond 1st April 18. then what it says is now you should deduct 2 million rupees profit from the cumulative profit as at 1st April 2018, and then from the comparative year ended 31st March 2019, and from the current year ended 31st March 2020, you should deduct 1 million rupees each. So, the value of the goodwill on 31st March 2020, the balance sheet should be 6 million rupees, and that is how you should word it. We are moving on to question number 3. Question number 3. Nikki Private Limited realized 1 million rupees in cash from the sale of land on 31st December 18. Until a suitable investment opportunity is found, Nikki Private Limited decided to invest the cash in medium term bonds. On 1st January 19, it purchased corporate bond with a contractual term of 3 years at its par value of 1 million rupees. Annual coupon rate of this bond is 9%, payable annually on 31st December. Bonds are redeemable with 5% premium on 31st December 2021. Effective interest rate is 10.5%. Immediately after a suitable investment opportunity is found, Nikki Private Limited intends selling these bonds. Therefore, the investment period is most likely to be shorter than the term of the bonds. However, if a suitable investment opportunity is not found, Nikki Private Limited would hold these bonds to collect interest and the principal amount. On 31st December 19, the fair value of these bonds has been reduced to 950,000 rupees as at this date. A significant increase in credit risk was not observed, and 12 months expected credit loss of these bonds were estimated to be 30,000 rupees. On 1st January 2020, Nikki Private Limited sold these bonds at 950,000 rupees required. Describe the appropriate accounting treatment for the above bonds as specified in 9. Financial instruments together with the double entries required to be made on 1st January 19, 31st December 19 and 1st January 2020. That is for 10 marks. I mean, the entire question number 3 has been from financial instruments, but from a very specific area. It is not kind of a holistic questions of which the contents are spreading all over the entire standards, no. But, you know, as you develop and construct the answer, you need to be little careful. A very good question, very good question. Right. Describe the appropriate accounting treatment. Now, accounting treatment for a financial instrument, this is a financial asset or a financial liability. It says Nikki Private Limited realized 1 million rupees in cash from the sale of land on December 18. Until a suitable investment opportunity is found, Nikki Private Limited decided to invest the cash in medium term bonds. They have made investments in bonds of another company. It is going to be a financial asset. So, ladies and gentlemen, dear children, the accounting treatment for a financial asset depends on how you classify the financial asset. So, SLFR is 9 talks about 3 kinds of financial assets: fair value through profit and loss, fair value through OCI, and measured at amortized cost. Now, in the world, in the entire universe, we talk about 3 kinds of financial instruments or financial assets. It can be either a derivative asset or it can be investments in equity in instruments of companies, or it can be debt instruments of company. So which category does this fall into? This is an investment in debt instrument. If it is a debt instrument investment, and if it was acquired for speculative purpose, for trading purpose, so without being hesitant, without asking from anyone else, you categorize it at the fair value through profit and loss. And if the investment was acquired exclusively for the purpose of collecting the contractual cash flows, and if that passes SPPI test, you categorize it under measured at amortized cost. And if the investment was made with both objectives of collecting the contractual cash flow so that it passes SPPI test and to collect the sales proceeds, then you need to categorize it under which category? Fair value through OCI. Initial measurement, irrespective of the category under which the financial instrument comes under, initial measurement should be fair value for all the categories. Subsequent measurement should be fair value under fair value through profit or loss, should be amortized cost under measured at amortized cost category. This is fair value through OCI category. Under fair value through profit and loss, whatever the fair value changes that arise subsequently at subsequent measurements should be recognized to profit and loss. Here, measured at amortized cost, you need to measure it at amortized cost, and then you need to recognize interest. Interest to the profit and loss is recognized using only the effective rate, and that is very important to be remembered. Here, any differences arising on subsequent measurement at fair value should be recognized to OCI. So that is the basic accounting for a financial instruments, depending on where this financial asset should be positioned. But apart from all that, here there is a small impairment review as well. So you need to do the accounting for the impairment as well. Now, first and foremost, before you start deciding what accounting should be proposed, you need to decide the classification of the financial asset. Now, the examiner has been very kind-hearted, very generous, open-handed. He has tried to give as many tips as possible for the students, make the students to understand that the entity has acquired the investment to collect both contractual cash flows and the sales proceeds. Why? They made the investment 1 million rupees and the entity spent 1 million rupees to buy the bond. This is what they think is the best investment for the moment. But before the maturity of the bond, if the entity happens to meet more favorable investments, more preferable investments, the investments which they think can be the best at that time, then they will sell the investment in the bond, collect cash and go for another investment. And if they do not meet another better investment, they will continue to hold on to the investment in bond until the maturity. So, it depends on whether this company investor will meet better investment opportunities in the future or not. So, they have both intentions, but they can't collect both cash flows. They can collect either contractual cash flows or sales proceeds, but they have both intentions. So, that is what matters the most. So, then how will you classify it? It has to be under fair value through OCI. Initial measurement, fair value, subsequent measurement, fair value changes to OCI. Let's see how the impairment is done as we proceed. Let me show you the accounting. Let me open up the investment account. Investment in bonds. Initial measurement is fair value, and the fair value seems to be 1 million rupees. Normally, transaction price is considered to be the initial fair value unless otherwise stated. Annual coupon rate is 9%, effective rate is 10.5. So, you should recognize interest income to profit and loss not on the basis of the coupon but on the effective rate. So, then effective interest that should go to profit and loss should be at 10.5. So, 1 million into 10.5% is how much? 105,000. Credit it to profit and loss and debit it to investment account, and then you are receiving the coupon. You debit cash and credit to investment account at 9%, should be 90,000. And if you close up the account and put the balance as the balancing figure, the closing balance is the amortized cost, which is wrong. Since this is categorized under fair value through OCI, closing balance has to be the fair value. So, the examiner has given us the fair value. Closing fair value should be 950,000. And any balancing figure should be the fair value change. So, let me see how much it is. 1 million plus 105,000, 1,105,000 minus 90,000 minus 950,000. So, the fair value change has to be 65. This is taken to OCI. Let me open up the OCI account. 65,000 fair value change. Now, if you conduct the impairment review of an investment which is in a debt instrument, the total drop in fair value should be further taken into two groups. Fair value change due to the change in the credit risk, and the fair value changes due to the market condition changes. And even in our webinar videos, we have explained that with the calculations. I am not going to explain that again. So, you need to rewatch the videos to brush yourself up. Examiner has been so helpful, and he has given the fullest possible support. If I were the examiner, I would not give that detailed information. For 10 marks, this is pretty easy. You should never blame the institute or the examiner. We should blame ourselves for not being able to score for a question, small question like this. And the fair value difference of 65,000 is pure. Partly because of the changes in the credit risk of the bond issuer and the fair value changes due to the changes in the market conditions. So, the examiner says on 31st December 19, the fair value of these bonds had been reduced to 950,000. As at this date, significant increase in credit risk was not observed, and 12 months expected credit loss of these bonds were estimated at 30,000 rupees. If the credit risk has not significantly increased, credit quality has not significantly deteriorated, you are required to conduct 12 months expected credit loss exercise. So, they have done it and given us the figure 30,000. Of this 65,000, fair value change 30,000 is because of the impairment, and the balance is due to the changes in the market conditions. So 30,000 you should pull it out from OCI and should be charged to profit and loss, should be charged to profit and loss. So this is what the accounting should be, accounting should be for the bond, and the examiner requires us to give the double entries as well. Now if you construct your answer, just giving this T account is not enough. Come on, that's not what the examiner is expecting. This is only just a support. Now remember, your calculations will not be the final solutions. You need to describe. First, you need to say this is an investment in debt instrument done with both objectives of collecting contractual cash flows and collecting the sales proceeds, and should be classified under fair value through OCI. Initial investment should be fair value, subsequent measurement should be fair value, fair value changes are recognized to OCI, interest income should be recognized to profit and loss based on effective interest rate of 10.5, cash flows should be at coupon rate of 9%, and since the credit quality has not deteriorated significantly, as the question correctly says, only the 12 months expected credit loss will be needed, then of this total fair value change 65,000, the impairment provision of 30,000 should be charged to profit and loss, not like the other impairment reviews. Here impairment is not taken to a separate provision account. Why? The closing balance of the investment is already after the impairment being deducted from. So as a result, you credit OCI by the amount of impairment loss and debit to profit and loss, and the investment is recognized to balance sheet at 950,000. So that's it. Then the double entries. Debit investment by 1 million rupees and credit cash 1 million. Debit investment by 105,000, credit profit and loss by 105,000. You can put a small narration, recognizing interest income at effective interest rate. Debit cash by 90,000, credit investment by 90,000, recognizing the receipt of coupon interest, coupon interest. Then debit OCI by 65,000, credit investment by 65,000, say recognizing fair value change of investment. Then say debit profit and loss by 30,000, credit OCI by 30,000, recognizing impairment loss of the investment. So those are the required double entries. So very simple. Even if you watch the webinar videos relating to financial instrument, you can score the full marks for question number 3. So we are moving on to question number 4 now. I have missed just one small information here. On 1st January 2020, Nikki Private Limited sold these bonds at 950. Then you debit cash and credit to investment 950, so there is no profit or loss. We'll complete the double entries for that as well. Debit cash by 950,000, credit investment by 950,000, sale of the investment. As you sell, the cumulative fair value changes recognized to equity ever since you acquired the investment, fair value changes, cumulative figures of fair value changes would have been recognized to equity, and that has to be transferred to profit and loss. Remember, you can transfer it to profit and loss only because it was a debt instrument investment categorized under fair value through OCI. What if that was an equity investment categorized under fair value through OCI? Then as you dispose of the investment, cumulative fair value changes you recognize to equity cannot be recycled to profit and loss. That has to be added to retained earnings. It does not come to profit. So here the cumulative equity changes of 35,000 should be charged to profit and loss. So one more double entry here as part of your answer. Debit profit and loss by 35 and credit equity by 35,000. That is the complete answer. So now you can move on to question number 4. Question number 4. You have been given the following scenarios relating to the technical threats, and this is from ethical part, not so hard. Also, let me go through the answers, suggested answers given by the examiner. You have been given the following scenarios relating to the ethical threats. First one, the accountant of a company is paid bonus based on the results of the financial statements which are prepared by him. Second one, the accountant of a company has been asked by the CEO to improve the net assets positions of the company by recognizing incorrect fair value gains. He has also mentioned that the accountant's year-end performance evaluation has been received by him and is pending assessment. A busy CFO of a company has recruited one of its close family members as the senior accountant so that he can rely on the senior accountant's work without doing a detailed review. Fourth one, a CFO of a listed company listed on the Colombo Stock Exchange has instructed the junior accounting team on the amounts to be incorporated in the financial statements as values of its properties. It should be noted that the CFO's wife is holding significant number of shares of the company required. Explain the ethical threat in each scenario and state one action that can be taken to mitigate the risk of violating ethical principles. Explain the ethical threat. So it's not that does the examiner want us to explain the breach of ethics. No, that's where your understanding is required. So we talk about 5 kinds of ethics, and here the examiner requires us to talk about ethical threats and one action that can be taken to mitigate the risk. The accountant of a company is paid bonus based on the results of the financial statements which are prepared by him. Now, the financial statements are prepared by the accountant, and the bonus which the accountant is entitled to will be based on the financial statements prepared by him. Suppose, what if you were the accountant and your bonus will be based on the financial statements, and what would you do? And you would try to inflate income as much as you can. You will try to exaggerate as much income as possible and try to bring this profit figure up. The bigger the profit figure, the happier you are. Why? Your bonus will be proportionate to the profit figures in the financial statements. And if the bonus figure will be linked to the amount of profit in the profit and loss, obviously there will be a bigger chance and a room for the profit and the entire financial statements by and large being manipulated by the accountant. So, being just a normal ordinary person, human being, everyone, almost everybody, even including you and I, will be greedy for money, and nobody can say no. So, the accountant will be like a duck to water, and he will be so interested in doing this exercise of preparing the financial statements on his own. He has been given the full liberty and the free hand to prepare it, to inflate the profits and to exaggerate the performances so that his bonus will keep increasing whenever the profit figure increases. So, there is what kind of a threat? There is a threat of self-interest. I love myself. I want my bonus to be high. I want my benefits to be high. I, that is the most selfish single letter in the alphabet. I, self-interest. We talk about selfness. That is the threat. And what should be the action to be taken? Immediately, this linkage has to be disconnected. His bonus should not be based on the profits. And his work should be monitored and supervised by some seniors, maybe the CFO, or it should be also taken to the notice of the audit committee, those charged with the governance audit committee. And sound internal control systems must be there for the transparency, in a way that the bonus will be linked to the profit, but the profit figure should be as much transparent as possible. As a result of the financial statements preparation exercise being scrutinized and monitored by some superiors and seniors. So, those are the actions to be taken. Let us go through the answer given by the examiner examiner. The accountant has a financial interest that could inappropriately influence his judgment or behavior, and he may try to manipulate the financial results in order to get the bonus. Actions that can be taken: review of the accountant's work by a person at a high authority level, disclose the relevant interest to those charged with governance, have a proper internal audit functions, bring these types of risks to the external auditor's attention. Right, good. Next one. The accountant of a company has been asked by the CEO to improve the net assets positions of the company by recognizing incorrect fair value gains. He has also mentioned that the accountant's year-end performance evaluation has been received by him and is pending assessment. Right. The CEO is forcing the accountant to include values of the properties, is it? Incorrect fair value gains to profit and loss, incorrect fair value gains. So, those fair value gains may not be genuine, may be fake, but this accountant is under pressure. He is forced to recognize those incorrect fair value gains into profit and loss. And the CEO says, your year end performance evaluation is with me and it is still pending. So, what does he try to say? You do what I asked you to do, if not your performances will not be evaluated good. And you are an accountant who should work according to my instructions. I will dictate terms and conditions to you. You should do it, if not you need to bugger off. What does he do? If the accountant will do what the CEO wants him to do, he will be evaluated good. And if the accountant does not do what the CEO wants him to do, his evaluations will not be good. So, now the CEO is doing what? Intimidation. Intimidation. Intimidate. Intimidation. What do you mean by intimidate? Tarjanin by a gannon. So, there is intimidation threat. Now, the accountant will be scared of losing his job and he has to be like a puppet dancing to the tunes of the CEO. Now, this man has to do, if not he will be losing his job. An intimidation threat is where you will be forced to do something which is against the good practice of accounting. What are the actions? Let me go through the answer of the examiner. The accountant is facing an intimidation threat as the CEO has mentioned his performance evaluation. The accountant may try to improve the net assets position by recognizing incorrect fair value gains so that his performance evaluations will not be adversely impacted. Actions that can be taken: review of the accountant's work by a person at a higher authority level other than the CEO. Communicate to those charged with governance, the board, have a proper internal audit functions, have an effective performance appraisal systems to avoid this type of thing, accountant to seek advice from CA Sri Lanka, and you need not to write the entire list, just one is enough. The examiner is asking you to state one action that can be taken. Third one. A busy CFO of a company has recruited one of his close family members as the senior accountant so that he can rely on the senior accountant's work without doing a detailed review. CFO has recruited one of his family members as the senior accountant. And he has left all the matters on the hands of the senior accountant, and this man is not bothered. Now, the accountant once again has got the entire freedom of the company to do whatever he wants to do. He can manipulate the financial statements, and there can be, you know, manipulations of the financial statements. Why? The CFO relies on the work of the accountant and CFO has left everything on the hands of the accountant. So, what kind of a threat? It is going to be familiarity threat. And let us see the actions taken or to be taken. Familiarity threat due to the close relationship that the CFO has with the senior accountant, he will be to accepting the senior accountant's work without carrying out a detailed review. As the CFO is responsible for all the financial matters of the company, errors and manipulations are highly probable. Actions that can be taken: establish a proper governance structure and procedures in a way that the CFO is required to carry out proper detailed checks, the HR division to handle recruitments. Fourth one, a CFO of a listed company has instructed the junior accounting team on the amounts to be incorporated in the financial statements as values of its properties. It should be noted that the CFO's wife is holding a significant number of shares of this company. CFO's wife has a significant shareholding in the company. Shareholding in the company. And the CFO has given some figures or instructed the junior accounting team on what values of what amounts to be incorporated in the financial statements. Instructed the junior accounting team on the amounts to be incorporated in the financial statements as values of its properties. Right. And it should not be the values of the properties given by an independent valuer. Let the independent valuers give any amount, but the amounts of the properties to be recognized to the balance sheet should be the values given by the CFO. Why? He knows by any chance if he can inflate the property values in the balance sheet, the net assets will increase and that will result in the share prices increasing. Why does the CFO want the share price to increase, to rise? Because his wife is holding significant shareholding. So, by hook or by crook, if he tries to increase the share price, there will be a massive capital gain materializing to his beloved wife and he himself will be benefited from that. So, he has what interest and what threat? Self-interest. He loves himself and he wants his profit to be bigger. He makes use of him being the CFO to incorporate inflated property values into the balance sheet and to increase and to augment property prices so that values of the shares of the company will start rocketing up. Thereby, he himself and his wife can make capital gain profits through this exercise. Self-interest threat. What are the actions to be taken? Dispose the shares held by the wife of the CFO, ensure compliance with the financial reporting standards, disclose the relevant interest to those charged with governance, have a consultations with CA Sri Lanka. So, that ends our discussion of question number 4. So, we are moving on to question number 5, ratio question.